we obviously have this particular issue of, was the early church Roman Catholic, not just small c Catholic? So what evidence would you say there is to show the fact that, as you mentioned, the early church was Roman Catholic?
Well, I think what you have to do, though, is when you say Roman Catholic, that's going to throw people off, because some people will say, well, wait a minute, the early church was founded in Jerusalem. So
good point.
The Roman part came later. So how can you say that the early church was Roman Catholic? For the sake of conversation, like, don't get so hung up on the word Roman from that perspective. I think that's important for people to kick around, because the problem I think that we have with this is we don't understand that when we look at the Roman Catholic Church today and we see the Vatican and we see the Pope and we see all of these things and all of this institutionalized structure, and then we look at the early Christians who worshiped in homes, who were underground and were defined by poverty, really, and were persecuted, all these things. We look at that, and then we look at the Catholic Church of today, and we go, well, this doesn't seem to be anything like that. Therefore, they must be complete opposite. So I think that's the first thing we have to recognize. Look, the fact that the early church looked much differently is just a product of time and history and development. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean that these aren't the same organization, okay? Just like if you were to go back and look at the foundations of the United States of America, and you went back to to 1776 and you looked at this is what America looked like, and you looked at America today, you could say, well, is this even the same country? Now, it's going to have different aspects and different, it's going to look different, but it ultimately is the same country. So now, why do I think that? How can we overcome that seemingly strange problem of, well, okay, look at the church today, look at the early church. And the way that you find out what the early church was you look back at what the early church produced, the writings of those who were there. And I think when we start to do that, we're going to find some things that are pretty interesting. Now, of course, if you want to say what the foundational differences between whether something's big C or little c, you have to go to the papacy. You have to go to the Pope and the idea, which of course lends itself to the idea of apostolic succession. Did Christ found a visible church with Peter as the head, and was Peter's office passed down to other people?
Yeah.
That's the foundational question. And I think that when you look back at the history and the writings of the early church and the church fathers, the answer that you're going to discover is yes. So, I mean, there's no question that the bishops led the church. A couple places that were helpful for me, resources when I was studying this was a big one. St. Ignatius of Antioch, okay? Mm-hmm. He was a very early Christian. I mean, first and second century. I mean, he died in like the 107 AD-ish, something like that, I think. And he was a bishop of Antioch, and he wrote seven letters to churches as he was on his way to be martyred in Rome. And we have these letters today. And when you look at what he says in his letters, he talks a lot about the bishops, the authoritative structure, and the Catholic Church. Matter of fact, one of the best quotes of Ignatius of Antioch is when he says, where the bishop is present, there is the Catholic Church. And so I started to read some of these things that he says. And I mean, just listen to this quote, Josh. He says this, and this is, you know, he's right there. This guy knew Peter. This guy knew John. This guy like knew the apostles. He writes this, see that ye follow, that ye all follow the bishop, even as Jesus Christ does the Father, and the presbytery as ye would the apostles. Now, the word presbytery is literally the word for priests, okay? Mm-hmm. And reverence the deacons as being the institution of God. Let no man do anything connected with the church, that's big C, without the bishop. Wherever the bishop shall appear, there let the multitude of the people also be, even as wherever Jesus Christ is, there is the Catholic Church. Whatsoever the bishop shall approve of, that is also pleasing to God, so that everything that is done may be secure and valid. So right there, we see he's talking about bishops, priests, deacons with this type of authority. And so to me, that proves that there is this visible church. There's no question about it.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting when I started reading the early church fathers, I was so curious as to, and I even brought it up to a senior pastor one time of an evangelical church because I was curious. And you know what I found? I don't know if you found the same thing, Keith, when you started talking to, I mean, probably not because you were in ministry, but I was just a lowly layman. So when I would have these conversations with pastors, I felt like they get shorter and shorter and shorter, like because I kept asking more and more and more questions, like every question spawned three others. And so, but anyways, one of the ones that I asked was, I said, why was the church so seemingly preoccupied with listing out the order of bishops? And I said, because it's not, you don't just see it in Ignatius. You see it, you know, in some of the other early church writings.
Sure.
Where they're very concerned with so-and-so was succeeded by so-and-so was succeeded by so-and-so. And you see this long chain, and then you look at that, and I've been to Rome. My wife and I took a trip. We've been there twice, and we've been to the Vatican once. And just on that beautiful plaque in the front of St. Peter's Basilica that outlines the list of bishops, the time, or the list of the popes, the time that they reigned as pope, right? And so it's kind of hard not to draw this kind of seeming connection between the earliest Christians and, you know, what we see today.
I remember in Rome too, going to, maybe you went there too, St. John Lateran, where they have the pictures on the wall up top of, and I remember seeing that when I was still a pastor, looking at that going, holy cow. And this is when St. Pope John Paul II was still pope. And I'm looking at this around the room and it goes all the way back to Peter. And I'm thinking, these guys really believe this, you know, these Catholics really believe that their church and the authoritative nature of it goes all the way back to Jesus. And the thing that struck me was nobody else is even making that claim.
Yeah.
I mean, we weren't making it as Methodists, and none of the other churches I was a part of, no church I'd ever heard ever makes that claim and has that level of historicity that can back that up. You know, and I know that people want to say things like, oh, well, the Catholics just doctored that and they messed that up and this and that. But I mean, you can look back. I mean, another guy that's really helpful to understand is St. Irenaeus of Lyons. And he's very early as well. And what he does in his writing against heresies is he makes the same point that you made a second ago about why is it so important to trace back their teaching to the apostles? It's so that they can protect the true teaching of the faith. By saying, look, what we believe is traced back by these, you know, connections, and what you're talking about isn't. So therefore, we're gonna be the ones who can stay with confidence that we're teaching the truth of the Christian faith because we can trace it back, but you've innovated, you've departed from that. And here we go. I love this quote that he says. He says, since, however, it would be very tedious in such a volume as this to reckon up the successions of all the churches, we do put to confusion all those who, in whatever manner, whether by an evil self-pleasing, by vain glory, or by blindness and perverse opinion, assemble in unauthorized meetings. We do this, I say, by indicating that tradition arrived from the apostles of the very great, the very ancient, and get this, universally known church founded and organized at Rome by the two most glorious apostles, Peter and Paul. As also pointing out the faith preached to men, which comes down to our time by means of the successions of the bishops. For it is a matter of necessity, he says, that every church should agree with this church, Big C, on account of its preeminent authority.
Hey everyone, thank you so much for checking out this clip from the Practical Theism Podcast. If you enjoyed this clip and you want to check out the full episode, you can do so by finding it on our YouTube channel. Definitely consider subscribing and ringing that little bell so you can continue to get updates, notifications when we release new episodes and new clips just like this one. I hope to see you soon.